sent, which I meant to send yesterday, but I forgot, so my file didn't appear yet. Problems 17 and 35 depend on information that you've not been presented yet. So they'll be due next week, but the other problems, including problem 20, are due today, and the quiz will be on that section. So Sam sent out an announcement, and so you should have got an announcement that the two of the problems are due next week. So next week's homework set's gonna be pretty big. And I thought about making that homework set smaller, but you've got an exam about that, so I can't really push that later either. So it's just a big homework set next week. And if you've already done those two problems today, then you're ahead for next week. If you haven't done it yet, you don't have to worry about those two, because we're gonna cover that information, heat capacity, things like that, on Friday. Yes?
The test will still be over these two questions are still gonna be in the test.
Yeah, chapter 3 is on the test. Yeah, that's right. So the test will be over those two problems that are due next week. And the exam's coming up, remember the day, is it the 29th or something like that?
It's Monday, something.
No, Wednesday the 30th, yeah. Okay. It'll be Wednesday is the first exam, then Monday. All right, so look for that announcement. And you still have homework due today, but the homework set is scoped down a little bit because I'm a little out of sequence on what I'm teaching you. Although all the information is in the app, so you could have done it anyway. Unless you think I add value with the lectures, which I hope. So just sorry about the late notice on that. Also, the numeric answers to the homework problems will be sent out as requested. And I don't think that's happened yet. You guys can do that later today, is that right, or some point? So you'll get the numeric answers to the homework from now on. The idea of being, it'd be a good gut check for you as you're doing your homework, maybe to see the correct answer. Not the solutions, but just the number in the box, that kind of thing. So that's an important announcement update for you. I'm going to be gone on Friday. Dr. Robert Ferris is back there. Robert remembers his hand. He's actually listening to his lecture. He's going to give the lecture on Friday. And I've already taped the lecture. I taped it just before class. So that videotape will be up probably tomorrow, maybe, so I'm thinking. So the videotape of Friday's lecture will be up tomorrow, but come see Robert do it as well, because he's funnier and smarter and has better answers to your questions. So come see what he has to say about that. And we're going to talk to you about ideal gases. Before we talk about ideal gases, sorry about that cough, I think it's a ragweed or something. I want to talk about a plot of something that might be of interest to you. This isn't really even. Anybody know what that might be? 0 to 6, this is time. And that's a scale on the y-axis. Starts off at 4.0, plummets, it kind of crawls back out of the hole.
Your GPA.
That's my GPA at UT for over 6 years. So I started off with a 4.0 because I placed out of like 12 units with an A or something like that. So I came in with a 4.0. I came in perfect, right? Which I suspect a lot of you had credit coming in. And then I started to really flame out pretty quickly. Well, I think maybe it's more like this, so I should draw it.
Yeah, all the way down to 3.
I got only 3. Listen, so I took a lot of swimming and band. I got 3 A's of band and swimming. I started making a lot of B's and C's. I wasn't doing that great. And it was my spring semester, my sophomore year. I was in thermo. I got an A in thermo, though. It was like one of the few classes I got an A in those first 2 years. Like, for some reason, I liked thermo, or just thermo. I did my homework. By the way, if you want to know how to succeed in this class, do your homework. That's something I recommend. So it's not going the way I thought it should. I have this sort of sense of self that I'm a smart guy, I should get good grades, and I wasn't getting good grades, getting C's and B's and some courtesy A's along the way. And then the spring semester of my sophomore year, I was in the marching band still. The chancellor of the UT system, a man named Dr. Hans Mark, the chancellor had the entire Longhorn band and all the cheerleaders and the drill team over to his house for dinner. That's like 350 people at his house. And it was like Admiral McGraven's chancellor. So the chancellor then was Hans Mark. And Hans Mark had come to UT as chancellor from NASA, where he'd been the number 2 guy. He was deputy director of NASA. He was in charge of the space shuttle program. This guy's awesome. He had been secretary of the Air Force. He'd done all sorts of things. A brilliant scholar, a chancellor and all these things. And he had the entire Longhorn band over to the house for dinner. And so we go over there. And he says, you don't have to perform. You always have to perform. I'm just going to feed you dinner, then you go. And I just want to say thank you, because no one thanks the band or the cheerleaders. So I'm going to thank you guys, then you go. Well, I thought, that's pretty cool. Like, who says thank you to the cheerleaders of band? Like, almost no one, right? So we went there, we had dinner, and then we left. And I wrote him a thank you note. And I said, like, the next day, I said, hey, thanks for having us over for dinner. No one thanks the band. That's really awesome. Thank you for thanking us, kind of thing. And by the way, I'm an aerospace engineering student, and I'm doing pretty badly in my classes. And I'm kind of thinking of dropping out of engineering and being a poet or something like that. And, you know, could use some mentorship. What do you think? And his office, the secretary called me and said, the chancellor got your note. The chancellor would like to meet with you. I'm like, oh my God, what have I done? So I had to buy a shirt with buttons. And then I tuck it in. I go meet with him downtown in his office. And I meet with him, and it took an hour with me. He says, tell me about yourself. What's going on? And I said, well, you know, I'm a student. I've been playing too in aerospace engineering. I think I'm smart. At least I was in high school. But I'm kind of getting C's and stuff. And I probably shouldn't be, but I don't want to do my homework. I don't know what's going on. And he goes, well, probably should do your homework. He did say that. And I said, I'm thinking about dropping out of engineering. It doesn't really make sense to me. It's kind of hard. I'm not really motivated with it. And he goes, you know what? You need a job. I was like, what? What do you mean? Like, I'm already working as a waiter, counting line at this point. I got a job. He said, no, you need an engineering job, and you'll be re-inspired by engineering. Because if you get your hands wet doing real engineering, you'll like it. You'll fall in love with it again. Hang on. And he calls NASA. And he gets NASA on the line, because, you know, he used to run NASA. So he's like, hey, NASA, I've got this AB student in my room. Like, he's kind of lying for me, right? And I'm like, well, I've got A's and B's, so I am an AB student. I'm also a C student. And he says, I got a student here who needs an internship. And he got me an internship. It's kind of crazy. And I went to NASA Ames Research Center for 2 summers to do an internship, working on scramjets, supersonic combustion ramjets. So this was my, this was 2 summers in the middle of my 6-year undergraduate career. And so you could call this, you know, the free fall era. Not quite a free fall. I wasn't failing. Like, it wasn't a disaster, but I just wasn't performing the way I thought I should to match my own elevated sense of intellect and that kind of thing. And then we'll call this Michael Weber meets Hans Mark. Well, by the way, I also start dating a girl named Julia, who I'm now married to. We've been married for 20 years. So either she turned me around or he turned me around. I'm not sure exactly what happened. I was very interested in marrying her, and she was not so interested in even dating me. Yeah, but you know, we got it all figured out. So the free fall stops. And then I go to NASA for a couple summers in there. Well, I guess I'll wait for this stretch. And then, like, after this point onwards, I had a 4.0. It's kind of interesting. Not that grades really matter that much. You know there's no correlation between grades and success? You know that, right? A lot of you are like, yeah, I'm on something. President Bush gives speeches and commences, like, to all the C students out there, you could be president someday. That's what George Bush said. That was pretty funny. So, you know, grades and success really don't matter, but effort matters. And this is, we'll call this the 3.0 era. You know, so it was a disaster because I got all those A's from swimming and stuff. But it got better. It's amazing how many free A's you can get from the kinesiology department. Like, you can just take volleyball, right, and get an A. So I did a lot of that. I graduated with 232 hours, I think. You need like 130 to graduate. So I had 100 hours of free A's, right? Okay, so things turned around. I became a really good student after that. You know, I crawled back up, and I graduated. I think I graduated at 3.75. Like, that's a pretty respectable GPA, but by no means was it the highest GPA anywhere in the department or anything like that. So I was a good student by the time I finished, but my buddies, I think I was 4.0 students the whole way. I was there towards the end. And the difference here was my research in NASA. I worked at NASA, which was kind of interesting. And I worked on this supersonic combustion ramjet system. I need to erase this. I don't think this is that interesting. I'm gonna erase this and draw something else. I go to NASA. NASA has many facilities. There's Johnson Space Center, there's Kennedy Space Center, there's Langley, there's all sorts of places. And I was at Ames, the NASA Ames Research Center in the Bay Area, so in San Francisco.
Is that on Moffett?
It's at Moffett Field. So there's a Naval Air Station there, Moffett Field, and then Ames is right there next to it. So I lived there for a couple summers, did some work. I even got paid like $8 an hour or something like that. So a good prevailing wage at the time. And I worked on scramjets, supersonic combustion ramjets, which is a really fast plane, because for a while the United States wanted to invent a plane that could get us from LA to Hong Kong in like 2 hours or something like that. It would take off horizontally and land horizontally. So a rocket ship gets you that fast, but it takes off vertically and then doesn't land, you know, kind of thing. So they wanted something that they could reuse many times. So they do scramjet research. And Ames is important because this is where they did the atmospheric reentry research for the Apollo program. And the atmospheric reentry research happened in the 1960s when the Apollo program was big. And atmospheric reentry is a thermodynamics problem. It's also a fluid mechanics problem. It's all sorts of problems because the atmosphere gets really hot when you hit it at 18,000 miles per hour. And so you've got this blunt object, the reentry module, the landing module goes back up, you get the reentry module, come back down, it gets really hot. So you have your module like this coming in this way at a really high rate of speed, and you get a shock wave around it. Air comes through and it's here, it's just normal atmosphere, and then it's really hot and high pressure gases on this side. I mean, this the shock wave does wicked stuff to the gas. And they knew it was gonna be hot. Because if you send, I mean, it's just like the whole idea of things melting and burning up to come in the atmosphere like asteroids. So it's gonna be hot, and they were doing some analysis using the ideal gas law to figure out how hot it's gonna be. And if you do the ideal gas law, it would suggest that over here, it will be 58,000 Kelvin. Ideal gas law, we'll say that with constant specific heats. Now, what are constant specific heats? You can hear that from Dr. Ferris on Friday. If you have constant specific heats in ideal gas law, then it's gonna be 58,000 Kelvin on the other side of that shockwave up against this blunt force of this thing coming in. You don't want your astronauts or your equipment to burn out. So reentry is a major problem. That's really hot. So they said, we better do some tests. Let's build a facility, do some tests, really high speed tests to see what happens to the gases. And it turns out that these tests revealed this is wrong. The right answer is around 11,600 Kelvin, actually. Because what they found out is the ideal gas law doesn't work. Because the gases are no longer ideal at really high temperatures and pressures. And the gases change, their composition changes. And the specific heats are not constant. You're gonna learn that from Ferris on Friday. So some of these simple assumptions we use in the thermodynamics class are fun to teach you the concepts, but don't work in the real world or the real atmosphere as you're coming back in at really high rates of speed. So they built a large facility. That facility in the 60s was to test reentry, and then I came in the 90s, decades later, it had been shut down. They're rebuilding it to do scramjet research, supersonic combustion, high-speed combustion research, create a plane that would fly to Hong Kong in a couple hours. All right, so let me draw this. I don't know if I could draw this properly. How they do it. They have a system here. This is like a big gun barrel. They call this a ballistic ring. Then you have a blunt tube. Then you have a big tank. Then you have another tube, a bunch of windows. And then you have another tank system. And then you have another system here. I'll use this brake as part of it. You have another system. And these are connected. I just have a break in the board right there. And we'll call this the ballistic range. It's a gun range. And we'll call this over here the shock tunnel. You're going to create shock waves in this tunnel. And this is the test section. And they did a couple things. They call this the pump tube. Well, let me go right over there. Just almost there. This is the pump tube. And this is 75 feet long. It's a big facility. It's a long 75 foot long pump tube. Then you have a launch tube. And that is 25 feet long. Then you have a dump tank. Boy, does that sound horrible. 30 feet dump tank. Then you have a test section, which is 85 feet long. And you have, oh, I'm sorry, that includes all the way over to this part. The test section goes all the way to here. Then you have a nozzle. And that is 20 feet. I've not drawn this to scale, obviously. And then you have an 80 foot long driven tube. We'll call that driven tube. 80 feet. And then you have a 45 foot long driver tube. Okay, that's 65, 145, 150, 230, 260, 285, 290, 360 feet long. Football field. A little bit longer football field. This is basically as long as a stadium, and instead of a tunnel underground. And that's where I got to work. I thought that was really cool. And the way this worked, this was built in the 60s, using the 90s. This pump tube is basically a gun barrel with gunpowder, and you have a piston here. This is so not to scale. This tube's actually like this big around. It's like a cannon. You got a piston here, and you ignite the gunpowder in a gun barrel. It shoots the bullet, the piston, this way really fast. It goes this way. It's a light gas gun, they call it. And you got a little model here, a little tiny thing, and this piston pushes a lot of air to that model. That model goes that way, so the piston goes this way, this goes this way. And it's a light gas gun. I don't remember what that means there. It's a gun, but they're using light gas to combust rather than a solid fuel like a gunpowder. That's like a rifle. And then that flies this way and dumps the extra gas into the dump tank, because you don't want these gases to go in there. You want just the model to go in there. So this is the model. And the model flies that way when you ignite. Now that model is really like a cylindrical thing. So this is the model. And inside that model is a little space shuttle, which I can't really draw. So we'll call that space shuttle model. I'm sorry, I'm such a horrible artist. Space shuttle model. Because they did this for re-entry testing for the space shuttle in the 80s as well. And by the way, this model casing splits open as it flies. See if I can draw this better. So it's like a three-prong model that opens as it flies, and the space shuttle comes flying out that way. So you ignite the gas, you shoot the piston this way at higher speed, it squeezes the air to pop this model this way. The model starts flying through here. As it's flying through the dump tank, the model casing's opened up. It's called a sabot, a shoe. Sabotage is a French word for using your shoes to break machinery, which happened during some strikes and revolutions. So sabotage is sabot. You have sabot, your shoe opening up. Your model comes through here, your space shuttle model, or your Apollo reentry module, flies down here at something like Mach 1. So it's flying at around a speed of Mach 1, which is speed of sound. This little tiny model, which is, I don't know, a couple inches in size. It's a small model. It's hollow mass, that way. At the same moment, you have over here a mixture of hydrogen and helium and oxygen, and we have a diaphragm here, a breakable wall between the driver tube and the driven tube, and you ignite that at the right moment, that you've launched this model from the other side. It pops the diaphragm because this ignited hydrogen mixture gets really high pressure, high temperature quickly, kind of like an ideal gas in there, where you added a lot of energy all of a sudden, so it gets higher temperature pressure, creates a shock wave here, which travels that way. And that shock wave makes gases really freaking hot. And the shock wave comes down here, and then it bounces off the wall. So it comes all the way down, bounces off, and then you have really hot, high temperature, high pressure gases there that go through the nozzle and expand that way. And those gases go this way at around Mach 12 to 14. You got gases going this way, Mach 12, 14. You've got a bullet or a space shuttle model going that way, Mach 1. And then you can simulate Mach 13 to 15 events. What happens when this model hits the gases? That's reentry. And so this huge system to do that. Now, we were there to look at the aerospace plane, and we put in this test section a pitot rate to measure the pressure. If you've done your fluids labs like that, you'll learn about pitot pressures, that kind of thing. We want to know the velocity of the gases. We even put a model combustor there, and we burn. And this whole experiment would take like a month to set up and be done in about 30 milliseconds. You're just not like that. You hear a loud boom, the whole building would shake, and then secretaries would call us and yell at us that we didn't warn them that we're about to make the whole building shake, and then we set up another one for another experiment and rebuild the whole system. You're firing a cannon. You have to fire this at the precise moment to make the gases all meet here in this test section where you can take pictures through those windows of what's happening if you time your cameras just right, and you see how the things wobble, and you see the shock waves, all that kind of stuff, and then measure the pressure and temperature and combustion. That's all I got to work on. And I thought that was really awesome. So we were using lasers. We send laser beams through the gases because you can't put a thermometer out there because it'll melt. So you have to measure temperature with some non-intrusive way, which was laser beams. So we send a laser beam through, and by measuring the way the molecules would absorb the laser light, we could tell how hot it was, how fast it was moving, what species were there, that kind of thing. This system is really good old school engineering science. We wouldn't do that today. We just put a model on a computer. It was like, you know, with wrenches and things. You could like skin your knuckles. And that's like a sign of good engineering. You bleed from your work, I guess that's what we used to think. So I got to work on that a couple summers. And the most amazing lesson to be out of this is that the Edgar Gas Law is not ideal. The Edgar Gas Law breaks down in those really extreme conditions. In fact, when you get to air, I've got a chart to show you. Air starts to dissociate. Let's see if I can fold this up so I can show you the picture. The composition of air is not constant. All right, I'll try to zoom in on that. This is temperature on the y-axis. And up to about 2500 K, air is air. But around 2500 K, oxygen begins to break apart into O and O rather than O2. And then you have nitrogen start to dissociate from nitrogen N2 to 2N. And then you get ionization above 9000 Kelvin. The composition of gas is not constant. The specific heat's not constant. The ideal gas law starts to act differently. The law is fine, but the gas is no longer ideal. Gas starts to break down. In fact, if you plot the composition over time, you'll see that it's far from constant as you get to these temperatures. This is temperature now on the x-axis. I just showed you temperature on the y-axis. Now it's x-axis in kelvins. This is in thousands of Kelvin. This is funny. This says 10 to the minus 3. I think that should be 10 to the 3. And this shows the mole fraction in the air. So air, under normal conditions, say down here where it's hundreds of Kelvin, is mostly nitrogen, 78-79% nitrogen, 20-21% oxygen, and then other stuff. But as you get to higher temperature, the oxygen goes away. The O2 goes away, but O pops up. But at some point, O even disappears because it dissociates or ionizes in something else. Nitrogen breaks down, you get NO, you get a shifting species. They didn't know that. The theory wasn't good enough until they got to the experiments. They're like, oh, cool, atmosphere changes when you hit it really hard with a hammer at 18,000 miles per hour. So that was part of the research. Yeah, it was pretty interesting. We were looking at supersonic combustion, burning gases at high speed. So normally when you burn stuff, like in firewood, the air is not moving very quickly. It might move 20 miles per hour, the air through your fireball, that kind of thing. Through your Bunsen burner, it's like 26 meters per second or something like that. So it's fast, but not that fast. But then you get to a situation in your car engine, you inject your fuel air mixture, and still when it burns. But then you have a plane, it's flowing through as fast as the plane. What's a plane going, 550 miles per hour? Your combustion's occurring at 550 miles per hour. Then you want to go supersonic speeds. You want to go Mach 5? Well, how do you get gases to burn at Mach 5? You slow it down. So usually they slow the gas down, burn it, then accelerate back up. With a supersonic combustion ramjet, you can skip all that, and you can burn at Mach 3, Mach 4, Mach 5. So it's just kind of a cool idea. First, we ran out of funding, shut it down, and Japan took the leadership on that. But that's typical for American science, right? But it was a fun experiment. It's a fun set of things to work on. And it's sort of relevant to today, ideal gas law, and your phase of life, sophomores, and I hope you do better than I did as a sophomore. And then the specific heat you're going to hear about from Ferris on Friday. So that's all prelude. I was hoping I could fill the whole lecture with that, but I didn't. So I actually have to give you a lecture, too. But so we'll talk about ideal gas law really quickly on that. Any questions or comments on that? Any of you worked at NASA?
I didn't work at NASA.
No, okay. You have a question?
Just about the objects heating up when they break into the atmosphere. Is there an adiabatic process going on there that's actually causing the heating
Is it adiabatic?
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think there's a lot of heat being transferred from the gases. Well, so the shockwave's heating up the gases. Then those hot gases are heating up the reentry. And you want it to be adiabatic. So you insulate it so that none of that heat comes in and cooks the astronauts. You want it to be as adiabatic as possible. And we get close, but we don't get all the way there. So they spent all this effort building ceramic tiles and insulation and gluing it on. You can't screw it in because the screws melt. So you need really interesting epoxies that can take the high temperature and won't fall off. So that's why it's a big deal. When the shuttle went up in the 80s, this might not be something you're aware of, that tiles would fall off periodically, these insulating tiles. And that's a big deal because when the shuttle re-enters and doesn't have that insulating tile, it's no longer adiabatic in that spot, you get a hot point, you can burn through and kill people. And in fact, that happened in the early 2000s. There was damage to the surface of the shuttle, to the tiles, and then on re-entry, they broke up because it was too hot, the whole thing burned out. So it's a life and death situation set up. So you want it to be adiabatic. You get as close as possible, but it's not necessarily adiabatic. It's close. And if it ends up not being close, then the consequences are pretty severe. Good question. And I guess I'm suggesting a couple things. I'm suggesting you do your homework. you don't need to wait to do what I did before you get your act together. You might as well do it now. I recommend you find somebody you want to marry. That's the other point. You should write thank you notes. And ideal gas law breaks down. So those are all the points of today's session. Yeah, like just life lessons and everything, all at once.
All right, so ideal gas is continued.
We introduced this last time, which is that ideal gases behave like discrete billiard balls with elastic collisions. So ideal gases behave, the molecules behave like discrete billiard balls. With elastic collisions, meaning they don't feel each other's presence until they collide and then they bounce right off. But a billiard ball, when it's getting close to another billiard ball, it's not like it turns away halfway there. In the real world, actually, the gases that get close, the molecules start to feel each other. They have repulsive forces, that kind of thing. The ideal gases behave like discrete billiard balls. So it's not discrete, but discrete. It matters where you put the E, by the way. They mean different things. If they were discrete billiard balls, it means they wouldn't tell anybody about it.
Yeah.
But if they're discrete, it means they're isolated from each other. At really high pressure temperature, these assumptions break down. Or this assumption breaks down. And that's important because you can be really wrong. You can think the atmosphere is going to be 58,000 Kelvin instead of 12,000 Kelvin. Yeah, question here.
What did that assumption be on both sides?
Say that again? Would it, at really low temperatures? I think it's less an issue at low temperatures and low pressures. It's really an issue at the high pressures and high temperatures. So low pressures and low temperatures, the gas is really spread out. They rarely bump into each other. It's really dispersed, so it's ideal. So low pressure tends to be ideal. Low temperature, the molecules aren't moving that fast. But you get to really high pressure temperature, they're all really close to each other. They're bouncing into each other a lot. They're moving quickly. They're squishing into each other. So it's more likely to be a problem at the higher pressure temperature, not the low pressure temperature. Low density, low pressure gases tend to be ideal. That's a good question. Any other questions? Okay, so really high pressure and temperature, really high P&T. By the way, we call that in faculty promotion and tenure. We have a P&T committee here. Like, is that a pressure and temperature committee? It's a promotion and tenure committee. But that assumption breaks down. Although I say promotion and tenure is high pressure, and you get really hot sometimes too. You get at high temperatures, you get ionization, you get dissociation. The molecules just break apart because they're so hot. One way to think about it is you have a molecule, you got two oxygens attached to each other, and they're vibrating, they're rotating, they're moving. At really high temperature, they're moving faster, and they just break the bond, they fly apart. That's ionization and dissociation. And at really high pressure, it's too close for elastic collisions. They feel each other's presence before they collide. All right, so then we might wonder, so when is the ideal gas law applicable? And how do I know? You can use something called compressibility to figure this out, or how can I adjust? How can I adjust from ideal if I think it might not be ideal? And first, you want to generalize the PVT relationship. We talked about PV and TV diagrams, a PVT surface, the three-dimensional state phase diagram surface. Generalize the PVT relationship. We have PV equals ZRT, or PV equals ZRT. So PV equals RT is ideal gas law. Let's insert Z, which is a generic term, correction term. We call that compressibility. Z is the compressibility factor. z as a function, I'm trouble writing, of the reduced pressure and reduced temperature. And we can define PR as the pressure over the critical pressure. The critical pressure is in the tables. We talked before, it's like the pressure at the critical point. And TR equals the temperature over the critical temperature. And we get those from table two. Well, we get the critical values from table two. If z equals 1, what does that mean? That means PV equals RT. And the ideal gas law applies. So let's find z, and I'll show you how to do it in a second. But to find z, if z is 1, it's ideal gas law. Because PV equals ZRT, but z is 1, so PV equals RT. Looks like the ideal gas law will apply. If z is not equal to 1, use z as a correction factor. Within reason. I mean, you know, if z is 0, it's not going to be so useful for it, but if z is 0.5, you could use it as a correction factor. I'll give you an example of that. Where do you get z, by the way? You get z from the compressibility chart. The reduced pressure, okay, let me zoom out. There's a chart just like this in the app. Or similar to this. You have reduced pressure, PR, at the bottom. And you have different reduced temperatures for different species. And you can look up what z is. Z is on the y-axis. And so, PR is reduced pressure. And TR is reduced temperature. And you could look that up off this chart. So let me do an example. We have acetylene tank. And it's at 100 kilopascals. At 100 kilopascals, which by the way is 0.1 megapascals. And the temperature equals 200 degrees Celsius, which is 473 Kelvin. And so we want to know, is that ideal gas law or not? So let's calculate the values. The critical pressure is 6.14 megapascals. And that means the reduced pressure, PR, equals 0.1 over 6.14 equals 0.016 or so. And the critical temperature is 308.3 Kelvin. And that gives you a reduced temperature of 473 over 308.3, which is around 1.5. And by the way, where did I get those? I got those from the table. Those from the tables. And so if we want to go to this chart, it's acetylene. PR is 0.016, and the TR is 1.5, it says. So we point on here. Well, here's the 1.5 line up at the top. You see where it says TR is 1.50? So this trend back and forth is where the reduced temperature is 1.5. And the reduced pressure is 0.0016 is way up here. So I'm way up in the upper left corner. That means Z is about equal to 1.
Okay.
That means Z is around 1, using ideal gas law. Maybe it's 0.98 or something like that, it's pretty close. Well, what if you have higher pressure? So now we'll do it again. Now the pressure equals 18.5 megapascals. This should be lower here. So it's 18.5 megapascals. And you want to know, how big a tank do I need? How big a tank to hold 100 kilograms of acetylene? Maybe you want to sell acetylene to someone and they wanted a high pressure. You want to know how big your tank should be. So you use your ideal gas law to calculate it, or should you? Well, at 18.5 megapascals, your reduced pressure is around 3. Your reduced temperature for same conditions is around 1.5. So you go to the same chart, reduced temperature is 1.5, but your reduced pressure is 3. You come up here, and all of a sudden, you're at this spot, Z equals 0.8. No longer ideal. At that high pressure, the gases are so close to each other, they're not behaving in a billiard ball way. They're not behaving in the ideal way. So Z equals around 0.8. So if Z is 0.8, what do? You want to find the volume. Well, PV equals ZRT, Z is 0.8, V equals the volume over the mass, and so you get volume equals ZRT over P, equals volume over mass. You can find the volume now. So you can use the compressibility factor as a correction term for ideal gas law. You can use compressibility to find out how close or not you are to the ideal gas law, and then correct away from it, if it's not ideal. And in this case, the pressure's too high. It's not really that hot, it's just more pressure thing. High pressure, squeezing those molecules together so they don't collide the way you expect. That's compressibility. And it's a weird function of the temperature and the pressure.
Dr. Robert?
Yeah.
Can you spell it out for me, why it gets better again as reduced pressure increases?
So the question is, why does it get better, meaning more ideal again, as the pressure increases? Mm-hmm. The temperature is the same, but the reduced pressure gets a... actually, don't know. It's a good question. So why does it have that shape? I got no idea. You guys should look that up and come tell me. I don't know. Let me see if I can think it out loud. So at really high pressure, your reduced pressure, PR, is the pressure over the critical pressure. At really high pressure, you're gonna have high reduced pressure. So for a while, it is getting worse or less ideal as you squeeze it together. But then if you keep squeezing it, I don't know, maybe it changes composition or something, but then it'll be the same term. I don't know, I think that went out loud. Let me go ask someone who's smarter, come back to you on that one. Anyone smarter in the room know that? Well, you raise your hand up.
Why is it the same for all gases?
It's not really the same, it's similar. First of all, these are similar gases, most of them, not all of them. Methane, ethylene, ethane, propane, butane, they're pretty similar. There's slight variations along the way. So they're not quite identical, but they're similar. And I think it's more of a fundamental phenomenon than chemical composition. That is a great question, I'm being plagued by that. There's another hand up here, yeah.
How much tolerance, like, away from one do you have to use that?
I would not use it below 0.2 by 0.3 around here. Like, you get down to here, like, at some point, it's just no longer applicable. So they cut it off at 0.1, but I wouldn't go below the chart, really. Yeah, I would think it's a rule of thumb, but, like, you're having to correct by more factor than 100%, like, more than 0.5, I would start being suspect about it.
I mean, like, without using the Z thing, like, using just
if it's like 0.97 or 0.98 or higher, okay. Just use ideal gas law probably. Yeah. Any other questions on that? I gotta figure this one out. Maybe Robert Ferris will give the answer on Friday. You know, we'll talk about it. You can answer that question. I'm gonna talk real quick about internal energy, you know, looking from ideal gas.
internal energy. And enthalpy. From ideal gases. Internal energy is the kinetic energy of that mass, the potential energy, plus the rotational energy, plus the vibrational energy, plus the electronic energy, plus the nuclear energy in that system. There's all these pieces about how quickly it's moving, it's rotating, vibrating, the nuclear energy and the atomic bonds, all the electronic energy set up in the chemical bonds, that kind of thing. And for an ideal gas, the internal energy of an ideal gas is only a function of temperature. It does not depend on the pressure or the volume. That's interesting. Ideal gases, their energy is really just a function of how hot they are. And because enthalpy equals U plus PV, that should make energy V. U plus PV and little h equals little u plus P little v. For an ideal gas, the enthalpy for an ideal gas is U as a function of temperature plus PV. But that's saying the same as U as a function of temperature plus RT, because ideal gas also PV is equal to RT, which means H is a function of T, of temperature only. So for an ideal gas, U and H are functions only of temperature. And that ends up being pretty handy. There are a lot of times where we know the temperature. Temperature is pretty easy to measure. Use a thermometer, that kind of thing. And we could use the temperature to get us energy and enthalpy. Changes are more interesting than the absolute value. So changes in U and H are more interesting than absolute values. And for enthalpy, H, we take the change, dH, that equals dU plus PdV, PdV plus VdP. So if you look at the change in enthalpy, it's related to the change in other things. The changes matter most, right? And changes in U and H are affected by the heat capacities and specific heats of the materials in question. So you're looking at a particular material, a species or something, and you want to know the changes in the enthalpy or changes in the energy. Well, those changes are affected by the heat capacity specifically, how much heat or energy that species can take, and you're going to hear about that on Friday. So we're setting you up for that lecture. Any questions on anything I've talked about today?
I don't remember seeing that in the book. That equation, dH.
This one?
Yeah.
You're going to see it later in the book. It's going to come up.
Okay.
It might be in there in chapter 3. Maybe it's in chapter 3. Maybe it comes out later. I'm giving you a sneak peek. It's not in the book? Okay.
It's there somewhere.
Well, it's not in the book you read so far.
Yeah, it's there.
I'm sorry. Okay, that's all I have for today. You are pretty good. Good luck on your homework and your class.